Judge, the South has been the base for your rather distinguished legal career and your judicial career for the past 25 years. But I know that you are not a native Southerner. When and where were you born?
Born in Washington, D.C., October the 19th, 1943.
Tell me about your early childhood and the communities in which you were reared.
I was born and raised in Washington and lived in downtown Washington, D.C. until I was seven. And then my parents moved to a suburb, Hyattsville, where we stayed until I was 16. Then when I was 16, we moved to Charles County, Maryland, which at that time was out in the country. My father opened a business there. My father and mother, both native Washingtonians, neither of whom worked for the government, which is a rarity, went to Gonzaga High School, which is a Jesuit high school in Washington, D.C., graduated there in 1961.
What is your father's name?
Thomas W. Carroll.
As you indicated, he had that rare distinction of actually having been born in Washington, and
that's
so
right.
Was your mother? So was your mother.
And my mother was also.
Her name?
Angela F. Carroll.
What did they do in Washington while you lived there until you were about seven?
My father and mother both were in the credit bureau industry. They both worked for the Credit Bureau of Washington, D.C. They were office workers. My father did not have a high school education, and my mother did.
Are both still living?
My mother died in October 1980, and 6 months later, in April of 1981, my mother died in October 1981, and then 6 months later, in April of 1982, my father died.
Did you have siblings?
I'm an only child.
Were there any grandparents who were part of your family unit when you were growing up?
When I was born, my grandparents on my father's side had died, so I did have a lot of contact with my grandparents on my mother's side. In fact, my grandparents on my mother's side lived with us until I was in college when they passed away.
What was it like having another set of parents in your household when you were growing up?
There were both good and bad points about that, as I think there would. My parents worked, so there was somebody when I came home to take care of me. At the same time, we lived in a fairly small house, and so two families in a small house has its own set of inherent conflicts.
Were both grandparents retired from any occupation or business at that time?
My grandmother had never worked outside the home, and my grandfather had actually been in the bicycle business early in his career and in the sporting goods business, and he also was retired at that point.
Before your family moved to Hyattsville, I assume that's Maryland?
Right.
Did you have any of your early schooling in the D.C. public or private schools?
I was always in Catholic schools. I started out at St. Martin's, which was right in downtown Washington, D.C., and everybody, my parents and now my wife particularly, loves to tell the story that I was thrown out of kindergarten because I was unruly, and that was true. Back in those days, of course, you could go to kindergarten if you were going to turn five before January the 1st. So I actually went to kindergarten when I was four, which turned out to be a serious error. But I do have to admit I was thrown out of kindergarten, but I was readmitted to the first grade.
Oh, to your credit, readmitted. Your parents were Catholic?
They were.
Grandparents Catholic?
Same.
Did you have any choice about the matter?
Recalling it, I don't think I had much of a choice, but I'm happy that I didn't have a choice because,
You have remained, shall we say, a staunch Catholic throughout
Absolutely.
Your adulthood. Hyattsville, Maryland, what was that like in contrast
it was
to
a,
Washington?
We lived in what are fashionably called brownstone houses, but were really row houses back in those days in Washington, D.C., with a coal bin in the basement. Just an aside, about 10 years ago, I took my daughter and wife back to Washington, D.C. on sort of a roots tour to show my daughter where I had grown up. And the house that I was born in is still there, but it is now in the middle of a drug war zone. And when I pulled up the car in front of the house, the people on the front porch immediately ran in because I was dressed in a suit. And I'm sure they thought I was a narcotics agent. But You know, Hyattsville was a typical 1950s suburb.
Mm-hmm.
All the houses the same, one of these tract house developments right across the line from Washington, D.C., but had the sort of typical, you know, growing up in suburbia experience. Went to St. Jerome Catholic Elementary School at that point in time, played Little League baseball, interested in sports. My father was a big sports fan, as was I. We went to watch the Washington Senators play, the Washington Redskins play, that sort of thing. So very typical, regular old, run-of-the-mill 1950s growing up period.
I know that you don't have much to compare with, but I'm interested in knowing how you feel your exclusive training in Catholic schools through high school influenced you.
I think that the best education I got to do what I have done, which is be a lawyer, was a training I got by the Jesuits in high school.
And why do you say that? What was special about that training?
Just the focus on logic and thought and that sort of thing. I mean, I really did get from them the sort of legal reasoning and the deductive thinking, the syllogistic thinking that you use in the law all the time. But that's what we were taught in the Jesuit high schools back in those days. And we were also taught a broad range of subjects. I mean, I had 4 years of Latin. We were in the early days of advanced programs, so I had calculus in high school and advanced physics in high school and that sort of thing. So I think the education I got there really prepared me well for anything, and I really think that's the cornerstone of whatever success I've had in education, was the training I got there.
Was it during this period that an interest in law was stimulated?
I had absolutely no interest in the law, didn't really know what I wanted to do, quite frankly. As I said, my father never graduated from high school, and my mother graduated from high school, but neither were what you would call professionals. There really wasn't a lot of push from them one way or the other. So I just knew when I got out of high school that I was going to go to college, really did not have any design, grand plan, anything like that.
What was it then about your high school period that ended up, in hindsight, influencing you most? I mean, what was it about your experience that today you look back upon and recall with any degree of fondness?
You know, just lots of good opportunities. I mean, I was on the debate team, and we did a lot of traveling. I was an officer in the student body and then on the student council. I mean, just a lot of opportunities, and I guess the realization that I had some skills that I could use later on in life. It's sort of self-confidence too at the same time.
Now, having been born in the seat of our government there in D.C. and being reared so close by through high school, to what extent were you affected by what was happening in Washington?
You know, I don't think at all. We were, back in those days, Washington was this incredibly little sleepy southern town. It was still, although not de facto segregated, I mean, not de jure segregated, there was still significant segregation. I remember growing up again in this white middle class environment, not being much affected. I mean, the most important things to us back in those days were whether we beat our high school rival St. John's in football or not, or how the Redskins or the Senators were doing. I don't remember having any sort. I remember having discussions with my father about political issues. And I mean, I think he was the one that really stimulated those sorts of discussions. But in terms of having those broader areas affect me personally, just didn't happen.
You mentioned that you would describe your environment as white middle class. Many who are native to the South believed that the North was somewhat of a mecca, and of course Washington, D.C. was lumped into that general category of the North, but there was a widespread belief that in the North and in areas like New England and the East Coast, the races were together on a frequent basis. Give us an idea of how much interaction you had across racial lines when you were growing up there in the Washington, D.C. area.
The only interaction I had were the people in high school with me.
So your high school was desegregated?
It was, although, as you can imagine, there weren't huge numbers of African Americans in the school, but enough that, you know, you had daily contact with African Americans both in the classroom and on the playing fields and that sort of thing.
In your housing environment, though, was that principally all white?
It was absolutely all white.
How would you describe any tensions, if any, that you were aware of between the races before you graduated high school?
I didn't graduate. I graduated in 61, and I think prior to that time, I didn't have much of a sense of those sorts of things. They weren't racial issues. There may have been some discussions about racial issues. I'm satisfied that my grandfather particularly had the view that African Americans ought to be in their particular place and that mixing the races was not a good idea, but it was never a view that was forced on me. My father, who again was the prominent influence in my life, was very open-minded. But again, we did not mix races socially at all. The only contact I would have had would have been in high school.
Are there qualities or personality traits you discern in yourself now that you can trace uniquely to your mother or to your father or to a grandparent?
I think all to my father. I mean, I think he was someone who was really interested in community service. I think he was somebody that was not easily riled, that kind of had the big picture, was fairly relaxed, that sort of thing. I mean, he was, I think a lot of the way I am came from him.
And as an only child, did you consider yourself getting a lot of preferential treatment, or was that somewhat of a lonely existence that had you wishing for a brother or sister?
I felt that I wasn't, everybody thought that as an only child, you just had this tremendous existence where anything you wanted was heaped on you, anything. And of course, financially, we weren't particularly well off. So that wasn't true from that standpoint. But it really occasionally came to be a lonely existence. I'll give you one example. There was a Catholic camp in the summertime that you could go to. And the kids I hung out with were all much larger families than I. They all got to go, but I didn't get to go because as an only child, what my parents made, I didn't make the income level cut, so to speak. But it really wasn't bad. I mean, I don't recall at all feeling bad about the fact I was an only child, just occasionally having to defend myself against the stereotype that you got everything you wanted whenever you wanted it.
Aside from athletics, did you find yourself engaging in any particular hobbies that satisfied you during your high school years?
I think the only, you know, I was on the debate team and spent a lot of time working in the debate area, but I don't think I ever had any kind of hobbies. I mean, it was always sports that were my interest.
Now, you say it was always a given that college would be in your future, though your parents were not the models themselves for that. Why was that? Why did you have that interest in going to college?
I think mainly through high school. There was a competitive entrance exam to get into this high school. I scored one of the highest scores on the entrance exam, so I was placed in this section, the advanced section. And I think it was understood from the moment we got in there that you were preparing yourself to go to college. So,
tell me how you made your choice of a college.
Very interesting story is I got scholarships to Georgetown and Boston College, which were traditional Jesuit schools. My father had a contact at work who mentioned the Naval ROTC scholarship. And I applied and was accepted, but could not pass the eye physical for some reason. I had a slight astigmatism. And then in May of my senior year of high school, I took a re-examination, and the Navy decided that I was okay at that point. So they gave me a Naval ROTC scholarship, which was, at that time, about as good as it got. It was full tuition, full room and board, $50 a month, spending money, and all your books. I mean, it was just a really good deal. But the way the Naval ROTC scholarship worked is you had to find a school that at that point had some slots open. So at that point, I started looking around, and Tufts University in Medford, Massachusetts had a slot, and a friend of my father's son had gone there and highly recommended it. So that's how I ended up at Tufts.
And you spent your entire college career at Tufts?
Yes.
Was your father a veteran?
Yes, he was in World War II in the Army.
Either of your grandfathers?
No.
Had you any trepidation at all getting involved with the ROTC and getting your foot in the military door, so to speak?
Well, you understand, back in those days, if you didn't go into some sort of program like ROTC, you were drafted. That's when we had the universal draft. And so as a male growing up, either you could figure out some kind of deferment or you were going in the military. And early on, since my father had been an enlisted man in the Army, he said, if you're going to go in as an officer. It's a much better life.
Was he a Navy man as well?
No, he was an Army.
Army enlisted. All right. You told me that.
But as far as trepidation goes, I mean, back in those days, as contrasted to today, going in the military was accepted. Going in the military was thought to be a good thing and an honorable thing to do with your life. It's only as the Vietnam War progressed and things like that begin to happen that the military really came under lots of criticism. So when I went in the Naval ROTC, everybody thought that was a really good thing to do. It was an honorable thing to do, and in addition, it was a great way to get college paid for.
How did you enjoy your ROTC experience, and what was it like?
I really liked it. I mean, I look back on my days in the military as some of the best things that I've ever done. So I enjoyed the ROTC life, and I enjoyed all the things that the military taught me.
Well, before we get to your military career, let's focus a bit on your college years. You're at Tufts in Medford, Massachusetts.
Right.
Were there many other colleges in the surrounding community?
Medford is right next to Cambridge. I mean, Boston is the best place, I think, or certainly was the best place back in those days to go to college because it was a college town. I mean, there were colleges everywhere.
Over a dozen colleges.
At least.
Just within the 50-mile
right.
radius.
Yep.
What was Tufts like in 61?
Tufts was the brochure describes it as a small New England college of high quality, and that's exactly what it was. Most of the students were from the New England area. It had about, I think back in those days, about 3,000 students. Nice campus. Again, what you would, if you could picture what a small college was like in the late 50s, early 60s, that was Tufts.
Now you were in college between 61 and 65,
right.
Is that correct?
Right.
At a time in our country when much was happening politically, culturally, and socially, and many revolutionary events occurred during the early 60s, so much so that some view the opportunity to be in college then as a blessing, and others look back on that time and say that it was their misfortune to be on a college campus in America in the early 60s. What's your perspective? How did you view the chance to be in college, particularly in the New England area as you were, between 1961 and 1965?
I would like to say that being in college was this great, wonderful, eye-opening experience for me back in those days, but that is not true. I mean, again, I was a pretty typical college student at the time. I was worried about trying to get through. I was worried about what was going to happen on the weekend. I was worried about what were we going to do socially during the week, that sort of thing. The only thing that began to creep in, and as far as the civil rights movement goes, that was never something that was really in the forefront of what I was thinking about. I mean, there were lots of kids on the Tufts campus back in those days that were heading south in the summer times to work in voting rights drives and that sort of thing. But I really didn't have lots of contact with those kids. I mean, I had some in classes, but in terms of the people that I hung out with, I mean, I'll be perfectly frank with you, we were far more interested in partying than we were in the more important things, social things of life.
You were aware that they were going on.
Right, for instance, I remember I was home in the summer of 1963, one of the obligations you had in Naval ROTC is that you went on active duty during the summertime. So I remember August of 1963, I had just come back off of active duty, waiting to go back to school, and saw Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech on television. It was broadcast live in the Washington area. I don't know whether it was broadcast live other places. But I remember seeing that, and I remember that being the sort of first awareness that I had about this. That was really... For instance, I really don't have a great independent recollection about the Montgomery bus boycott or the attack on the civil rights riders here in Montgomery. I really don't remember if I heard about it, it didn't make any sort of indelible impression on me. The first really sort of indelible impression was Martin Luther King and the I Have a Dream speech, because I saw that.
What was the impression, though, that you were left with after seeing that 1963
Thought it was the greatest speech,
speech
I had ever heard. Thought that obviously this was now an issue that was going to probably impact on my life. But again, 63, I'm just out of my junior year in college. Is that right? Junior year 63. Yes, just out of my junior year in college, I guess, or sophomore year, I can't remember which. Just remembered that having a tremendous impact on me.
Do you remember where you were when the news of President Kennedy's assassination
Absolutely.
Reached you?
I had a 1:30 philosophy class at Tufts and was walking from the building where the philosophy class was held back to the fraternity house where I was living, walked by one of my friends who just mentioned that. I remember running back to the fraternity house, walking in the door, everybody's huddled around the TV and watching Edward R. Murrow say President Kennedy had died.
How were you moved by that experience?
Well, to growing up as a Roman Catholic, Kennedy was our absolute idol. I mean, we had always felt like this notion that, that we had been the victims of serious discrimination, because any time a Catholic was even mentioned for president, the crazies came out of the woodwork and talked about the Pope running the country. So when Kennedy got elected, for us, it was as if these tremendous bonds had been lifted from us, that finally we could be on the national political scene. So when Kennedy was killed, I mean, it was just awful. I just remember it being, you know, and particularly being in Boston at the time, which is where Kennedy was from. I mean, this huge pall came over the city, and I felt that pall.
You had related to him as a Catholic. Had you any bond with him based on his politics while you were at Tufts or before you got to Tufts?
My father was a, what in Alabama would be called a Yellow Dog Democrat, and people have asked me why I've always been a Democrat. And the reason is, one of the reasons, is when I was growing up, my daddy always told me that the Democrats were for the poor folks and the Republicans were for the rich folks. And certainly growing up as an Irish Catholic, that was true, you know. So I had that additional sort of Democratic kinship with the president.
To what extent were you able to cement your Catholic upbringing and your Democratic leaning while you were at the Tufts community? You've described it as a small college, but you're right in the middle of so many other college communities, which could be described, many of them, as radical during the early 60s. To what extent were you comfortable with your climate there at Tufts?
The radicalism really didn't happen until after 65, the serious radicalism. I mean, quite frankly, from 61 to 65, Tufts was one of these idyllic, like as I said, we were interested in where the party was that weekend, whether we were going to be able to get papers done by the end of the semester, that sort of thing. Certainly the people I ran around with, we weren't deep into any of those issues, and I think they came later. Back to the Kennedy business, let me follow up on that. Some friends of mine and I decided that we wanted to go to Washington just to be there during the Kennedy thing. And it was during the time when Kennedy's body was laying in state in the Capitol Rotunda. Somebody had told us that if we wore our uniforms, that we get right in, that we did not.
ROTC uniforms.
Right, we did not have to go through the line. So we drove all night to Washington, D.C., got there early in the morning, put on our ROTC uniforms, and got admitted right in. And I'll always remember passing President Kennedy's coffin and giving it a salute. I mean, that's one of those moments I will always remember. But knowing I was going in the military, we then began, those of us that were draft age and committed to the military, began watching the developments in Vietnam. And I particularly remember when I was a senior, knowing that come June of that year I was going in the military, I remember when the president ordered the first airstrike against North Vietnam, because that was, for the first time, something that you were saying to yourself, we're possibly getting ready to get into a war, you're getting ready to get into the military, so these kinds of things may begin impacting on you. So really commencing from the time that we started bombing North Vietnam, I really began focusing on that. That was also about the time, the summer before my senior year, I went through Marine boot camp, because by that time I had decided I wanted to go in the Marine Corps. That was an option that you had. You could either go in the Navy or go in the Marine Corps. I chose the Marine Corps and had just finished going through boot camp when Vietnam really began to heat up. And some of our instructors in boot camp had actually been to Vietnam and been in combat, because the Vietnam War and our involvement actually began in the early 60s. And although that wasn't a huge presence until after 1964, they were there, they were telling us what was going on. So that's when you began to realize that unless something radically changed, sooner or later you were going to be involved in a war.
The boot camp was in 1964?
Summer of 1964.
And where was it?
Quantico, Virginia.
Why the Marine Corps?
I guess something, this fatal flaw that has sort of plagued me throughout life is always wanting to do the toughest kind of thing. And it just appeared to me that that was a really good challenge. And of course, my mother almost died when I told her I was going in the Marine Corps, but be that as it may.
The boot camp experience increased your resolve to stay with the Marine Corps?
Absolutely. I mean, what the Marine Corps boot camp is designed to do two things. It absolutely tears you down physically and mentally, and then builds you up to the point where you know or think you can run through walls. And it was just a great confidence builder, great experience personally about self-discipline and your ability to handle pain and that sort of thing, and your ability to make your mind persevere over what your body's telling you. I mean, it's just a really good experience for me. Self-discipline, lots of things.
I assume that you had no fear about personally getting involved in the war even before you graduated.
We've all forgot what it was like to be 20, 21 years old. You don't have any fear. You just, and I didn't. Never occurred to me. But again, I had come from a history of our country's involvement in war and that military service being one of the most honorable things that you could do. And that still, when I went in the Marine Corps, was I think the tradition of the country, which is military service was a good and honorable thing to do, even if it meant the possibility that you might not come back.
Your father certainly had molded, as you acknowledge, many of your personality traits. How did his actual service in World War II influence your own zeal for joining the Marine Corps and fighting for your country in Vietnam?
I think it played a part. I don't think he ever pushed me one way or the other, but certainly expressed no negative sentiments about what I was planning on doing.
Was there a large contingent of college students at Tufts who were involved in ROTC?
Back in those days, there were. Sort of driving factor back in those days was the draft, that if you didn't find a slot as an officer somewhere, you went in for 2 years as an enlisted man. Of course, things radically changed at Tufts after I left, and they burned both the Air Force and Navy ROTC buildings to the ground. I'm not sure they still have ROTC. I think Tufts got it back. But again, this was the period just before the real anti-military, anti-war sentiment began. There was some sentiment that was beginning to build, but I never got any sort of challenges from my classmates about being in the military, that kind of thing.
Did the burning of that ROTC building at Tufts happen while you were in Vietnam?
You know, I don't recall whether it was while I was there or just after I'd come back, but it was during that period of time.
Can you recall how you felt upon hearing the news that that building had been burned?
You know, by then I sort of had reconciled myself to the fact that there was another side to this story that maybe could be told, that the Vietnam War was not a particularly good idea. I think by the time I got back, although I was proud of my service in Vietnam, I think I understood just from having been there and watched the way the war was prosecuted that maybe this was not a good idea, although burning a building is never a good response to anything. But I think when I got back, I understood sort of the anti-war movement. And actually, when I was in Vietnam, I actually missed out on a lot of the anti-war movement really was beginning. I got to Vietnam in October of 67. And so it had just begun, was in its full flower while I was gone. I mean, the Democratic Convention of 1968 happened. And I don't remember any of that stuff being broadcast to us when we were in Vietnam, because there was censorship of the news.
Notwithstanding your described self as a fraternity man enjoying the party life, shall we say, I suspect that you did spend some time in class. Tell us about the academic studies at Tufts. What was your discipline?
Well, I got to tell you, I was a great student as a freshman. And then went downhill rapidly after that. I just got caught up in having fun in college and did not do very well.
What major did you choose?
I was an economics major.
Did you have a minor?
No. Partying was my minor.
You went to Tufts, certainly not motivated to be a lawyer and not clear on what your career path would be. Was there any time during your Tufts career that you got an awakening about what you'd like to do for the rest of your life?
Nope. I mean, I knew that when I graduated from Tufts, I was going in the Marine Corps. That was the sort of next step. And I was not thinking a whole lot beyond that.
Were you a single man during your college years?
I was.
Right. And before you went to the military?
Get married till after I'd gotten out of the military.
Well, let's take you to the military. Your boot camp experience got you in the right patriotic frame of mind. Vietnam was in full blown fashion by the time you graduated Tufts, and that was 1965, was it?
Right.
You signed up for the Marine Corps immediately? No
hesitation? Yeah, I mean, I was commissioned in the Marine Corps on the same day that I graduated and had to report to the Marine, back to the Marine base at Quantico at the end of June.
How long were you at Quantico before you were sent somewhere else?
6 months. Every Marine officer, regardless of what they do, goes through what they call TBS, the basic school, for 6 months to learn how to be a Marine infantry officer, the belief being that no matter what you do in the Marine Corps, your job is to support the infantry. And so for 6 months, I was in training there and made friends there that I still have today.
Are any of those friends in the legal field?
Only one is a lawyer in San Francisco.
After your training for 6 months, what was your next stop?
The next step was Pensacola, Florida. I had been assigned to become a naval flight officer. I was on track to be a pilot, but my eyes got in the way again. So instead of pilot training, they sent me to naval flight officer training, which could be a variety of things, all of which involve flying airplanes, but not as in the role of a pilot.
Did you go into the Marine Corps already with an interest in flying?
No.
Or any exposure to flying?
The development of the 6 months was, at the end of the six-month period, what do you want to do in the Marine Corps? Being an infantry officer was interesting, but didn't really excite me, nor being an artillery officer, those kinds of things. As I was in basic school, I got interested in flying. So by the time I was ready to get out of basic school, I knew I wanted to get into aviation.
How long were you stationed there in Pensacola with your naval flight officer training?
From January of 1966 to June of 66.
What was your next step?
To the Naval Air Station at Glencoe, Georgia. I had been assigned at that point to be a naval flight officer in an F-4, which was a radar intercept ground attack airplane. While I was at Glencoe, I was at Glencoe, Georgia from July of 66 into September of 66, and then they changed my orders. The Marine Corps got a brand new airplane, the A-6 Intruder, which is the airplane that pictured over there, and they needed air crew. So at that point, the Marine Corps sent me to the Naval Air Station at Sanford, Florida, which is near Orlando, to learn how to be a bombardier navigator, which was the naval flight officer position in the A-6.
How long were you there?
I was there until January of 1967. And January 1967, I went to the Marine Corps Air Station at Cherry Point, North Carolina, to an A6 squadron, Marine All-Weather Attack Squadron 225.
Were you in training there for Vietnam?
Yes. At that point, the A6s were going to be deployed into Vietnam, and so we knew at that point that we were being trained to go to Vietnam.
How was that a challenge for you, or did you view it as something scary? What type of perspective did you have between January and October, knowing that you were going to be headed toward this place that you only knew as Vietnam?
I think it was exciting, because if you were in the Marine Corps, you knew that combat was why you were in the Marine Corps. That's what you're being trained to do. That's what you were supposed to want to do. And everybody I was with, including me, wanted to do it and was ready to go and couldn't wait to get there.
How easily, Judge Carroll, did you make the transition from college student to Marine Corps? And I'm speaking in particular about your associations, because you've described your college life as one that you enjoyed principally because of your friendships, your activities. Tell me how you made that transition to a different kind of community there, the Marine Corps.
It was not a difficult transition, I think, because of the nature of Marine Corps training. I mean, the belief that you really were a member of a band of brothers, and that this brotherhood, this comradeship in arms, it was all true. I mean, I believe that and still believe that to this day, and that's what eased the transition. I mean, the people that I were with in the Marine Corps, this bond is something that you never ever lose and never forget. There's an expression that's true: once a Marine, always a Marine. And I think that's absolutely true. And so once I got in the Marine Corps, they became my family. They became most of my friends. I lost contact with most of the people that I'd been in college with, except for one guy, and that's a story that's real interesting that will weave into my life much later on. But it was not a difficult transition. And I, quite frankly, the notion of going to war and combat was a good way to kind of focus you on what was serious and important.
Between 65 when you joined and October 67 when you were getting ready to go to Vietnam, was there any experience you had which was not so pleasant or left you with a negative feeling?
I wouldn't say negative. I'll tell you the first unpleasant experience. The basic school class that I went through graduated from Quantico in December of 1966. Some of the people from my class that were infantry officers went to Vietnam within the next 3 months. And the Navy Times was something you read, and the Navy Times published casualty lists. And I remember in April of 1966, people from our basic school class began appearing on the casualty list. One of the guys that I was good friends with, a son of Italian-American immigrants named Tony Batista, lasted about 2 weeks in Vietnam before he was killed. He was the first casualty from our basic school class. So we graduated in December 66, and April of 67, he was mm-hmm. dead. And so that was a sort of a reality check.
What did you know about Vietnam before you actually went there in October 67?
That the Vietnamese had attacked American destroyers in the Tonkin Gulf, that precipitated bombings of North Vietnam, that the North Vietnamese and Viet Cong were an insurgent force trying to take over the South Vietnamese government. That was about it.
Did you head there, though, with a clear perspective on America as a friend or and the North Vietnamese as the enemy?
Yes.
Did you have a mission that you can now acknowledge? Did you personally go to Vietnam with an individual mission or an aim?
I think the mission was to go to Vietnam, do what was asked of you, and do it as well as you possibly could do it.
Would it be fair to say that when you shipped out in October, you believed that the war in Vietnam was a noble effort?
Yes.
And that America was right for being involved?
Right.
Was there any point during your time in Vietnam that perspective changed?
I think that it began to change around the Tet Offensive of 1968. And it was mainly because I did not believe that the war was really being supported by the South Vietnamese people and the South Vietnamese military. I don't think it changed my view significantly. I mean, there are lots of problems about the way we prosecuted the war and that sort of thing. But I think, you know, the Tet Offensive of 1968 was a sort of a milestone in the mm-hmm. war. I don't know whether you remember much about it or not, but that mm-hmm. was when the North Vietnamese decided to launch major attacks against mm-hmm. the American bases in the hopes that that, combined with the ill will that was being generated in the United States, would bring an end to the war. I mean, I really think that they thought if they captured a major American base or a major Vietnamese city, that the pressure to end the war in the United States would be so severe that it would end. And so we were under attack. And I can tell you some Tet Offensive stories in just a minute. But the night of the Tet Offensive, when it really began, the South Vietnamese Air Force left the air base at Da Nang and went somewhere. And we don't know where they went, but that night we came under heavy attack. And I think that's when we all began to think that, you know, maybe we were in this, the Americans, without really the interest and support of the South Vietnamese government. Plus, we had South Vietnamese women that cleaned our officers' quarters and that kind of thing. And we talked to them about what was going on in the community. And there was a huge amount of corruption in the South Vietnamese government, huge amounts of problems. And so at least that began to give you a feel for what we were doing there.
Let me be sure I have the facts right on your service there. You started in October of 67.
Right.
Did you stay for a 13-month tour?
13 months. Came back in late October 1968.
Did you re-enlist for a second tour?
Or no,
that
I was
your only tour in
Vietnam?
That was
my only tour.
All right. Give us an idea, though, of exactly what you did during your combat tour duty. What
well, let
was
me
your
begin
role?
By saying that as an aviator, our lives were much better than infantry officers and infantry troops. I mean, they had the worst part of the Vietnam War, absolutely. Ours was a much different environment. We flew night missions primarily into North Vietnam, so a typical day would begin in the early evening with a briefing where they talk about the targets you were gonna hit that night, what the anti-aircraft concentrations were, what had gone on generally that day in the country, what you could expect, that sort of thing. You'd finish that, go eat dinner. The launches began at dark, so you know you could get a flight anywhere from, be scheduled anywhere from like 10 o'clock at night to 4 o'clock in the morning. So depending on when you were flying, you'd either go back and go to bed or you'd do something else. When you were scheduled to fly, you'd go down to the flight line, look at your airplane, make sure it was all right, look at the ordnance you were carrying that night, and launch. And the sorties were always hour and a half, 2 hours long. Go up into North Vietnam, go out over the water off Da Nang, mm-hmm. go up the coast into North Vietnam, back out again and back down to Da Nang. I mean, it really almost became routine. It was just...
Because you were an aviator during the entire 13
right,
months.
Right. Mm-hmm.
How many missions did you fly?
About 240, 150, I think, over North Vietnam.
What was the hardest thing to handle about being an aviator during that combat period?
I think fatigue. For example, when the Tet Offensive, the Citadel at Hue was under attack, and the Marines were under attack by huge North Vietnamese forces at that time. So we were flying like 3 missions a day in support of Hue, and that's physically tiring. When Khe Sanh was under siege, the same thing. So the physical aspects of it were difficult.
And how did you confront that? What type of coping mechanisms did you have?
We drank a lot. And we played basketball and read, got out of country a lot. I mean, that was one of the values of being an aviator, is you could leave Vietnam. And there were always airplanes that had to be taken from Vietnam somewhere, and that was kind of scheduled. So that periodically you'd get some rest and that you'd get out and you'd get back in the real world for a little while and come back.
Overall, how did you find the 13-month experience in this strange country?
Because of the people I was associated with, a great experience.
What was most difficult to adjust to, other than the fatigue, of course?
Possibility might get killed, I guess. I mean, the first month I was with that squadron, we lost two airplanes and two air crews, all four killed. And, you know, that was a real sobering experience. Fortunately, we did not lose another airplane or air crew to combat for the rest of the time.
Are there any unforgettable experiences in Vietnam that ended up influencing the Judge Carroll that we know today?
I don't think there were any that influenced me. I mean, I think the unforgettable experience was the Tet Offensive of 1968. We had just come back from a mission in North Vietnam. It was early in the morning. We had just parked our airplane in what they call revetments, which is an area where the airplanes park. We were debriefing the mission that we had been on, and the sirens went off. And when the sirens went off, that meant that you were about to come under some kind of artillery or rocket attack. And sirens went off, and you could hear the rockets. These were 122-millimeter rockets begin to, we called it walking down. You can hear them hit. They have a real interesting sound. Mm-hmm. They go crump, real loud noise. But you can hear them, and they got louder and louder, and three or four of them hit where our airplanes were parked. And airplanes started burning. People rushed out of the hangars, started pulling these airplanes out of the fire. I mean, enlisted men, officers, everybody just kind of forgetting what was going on. You knew that if you didn't get the airplanes out of the fire, you're going to have serious trouble. And then I remember going back down the next morning and looking at the damage and the fact that I think three of our airplanes were just charred hulks at that point in time. So that was the flying combat in the air. You don't hear noises. Mm-hmm. You don't see flames, that kind of thing. I mean, it's almost surreal. You see the anti-aircraft in colors, and you see SAM missiles, but you don't hear them, and this was the, or feel them, and this was the first sort of visual experience with war.
When you completed that first tour of duty in Vietnam, did you ever consider re-enlisting just for another tour?
No, I really didn't. I think I had sort of had that experience. It was a great experience, but I didn't think that that's what I wanted to do for the rest of my life.
Had you cemented by then what you wanted to do for the rest of your life?
Nope.
So you went back to...
And I still haven't, by the way.
So you went back to complete your tour and
right.
The Marine Corps.
Came back to the Marine Corps Air Station at Cherry Point, was assigned to a squadron training air crews that were going to go to Vietnam since I had just come back.
That's Cherry Point, North Carolina?
Right.
You were there then from 69 to 71?
Got back to Cherry Point... Reported back December of 68 and was discharged from the Marine Corps December the 31st, 1969. So about a year.
You were discharged as a captain.
Right.
Was Captain John Carroll the same John Carroll who had entered the military in 1965?
Absolutely not.
In what ways were you most changed?
A lot more self-confidence, a lot more self-discipline. And there's nothing like getting shot at to kind of give you a better perspective on life. Things that might have been really important before didn't quite seem so important.
How had the America you left changed by the time you got back?
When I got back, it was a radically changed America, not necessarily for the better. When we landed at San Francisco coming from Okinawa back into the United States, and you know, walking through the San Francisco terminal in our Marine uniforms with ribbons on and that kind of thing, and people jeering at us, openly hostile, that sort of thing. Got back.
How did that affect you?
Well, at that point, we were really seriously thinking about starting a major fight, but we decided not to do that. And then the three guys that I came back with all went our separate ways. Got back home. And the reception of the people was far different than I expected. I expected to be sort of welcomed as a returning war hero. And the people, even close family friends, were not openly hostile, but it was like, you know, you're one of those people. You've been over there and you've done all these terrible things. So the reception was so bad, quite frankly, that I cut my leave short. I had a month, actually about 6 weeks before I was supposed to go back. I cut my leave short and said, I'm going back. and went back to the people that I knew and cared about back in the Marine Corps. Just it was not worth my time being out in the civilian world. They were just, folks didn't like you, they were hostile, thought you'd done something awful, and so I was happy to go back with the people I've been in combat with.
How was the reception from your immediate family, your mother, your father, your grandparents?
Well, my grandparents were dead by then, so my parents greeted me at the airport in Washington, D.C. when I landed, and you could tell it was a tremendous sense of just relief. You could also tell that the year that I had spent there was a tremendous, tremendous stress on them. They had really, really aged in the year that I'd been gone.
Mm-hmm. Did you find it easy to put that year behind you and move on to another phase in your military career, that is the year in Vietnam?
Yeah, I mean, I think the next phase of your life comes, you put that behind you, and so the next year I spent training new air crews, but also at that point deciding that the Marine Corps wasn't for me, that I needed to think about doing something else.
And what did you think about doing?
No idea. There were job fairs that popped up for military officers that were getting out, and I interviewed at a couple of one of these job fairs and got two job offers. And you talk about sort of things, paths that your life takes. The two offers I got, one was Alderman Studios in High Point, North Carolina, which was a furniture advertising business that was looking for somebody to go on the road as their representative, which really would be a traveling salesman, and do that kind of thing. The other one is fascinating. The other one was an offer from Electronic Data Systems in Dallas, Texas, which was run by Ross Perot, to be a corporate recruiter for them. In other words, go around the country recruiting people to go to work for Ross Perot. And I went down to Dallas, interviewed with them. They offered me a great job, but that place scared me.
What scared you about being in Dallas, Texas, with the corporate headquarters of Ross Perot?
You know, just a little too conservative for my taste. And I don't mean that. I don't mean that in a negative way. But that firm at that point in time was, you wore wingtips, white shirts, and maybe I wanted to do that, maybe I didn't, but I guess I didn't want people telling me that I had to do that. And it was just the sort of party line that company had, the feel that it had, that scared me. So rejected them, went to High Point, North Carolina. And of course, by this time, I had met my wife.
When did you meet her, and how did you meet her?
Met her in the spring of 1969 on a blind date.
This is Susan.
Right.
Where were you?
The Marine Corps Air Station at Cherry Point.
So your relationship actually started while you were in the Marine Corps.
Right, but after I'd come back from Vietnam.
When did the two of you marry?
In March of 1970.
And you have a child?
Right.
When was that child born, and what is her name?
July of 1978, and her name is Catherine.
Tell us a little bit about Catherine.
Catherine is graduated from Eckerd College in St. Petersburg, has been working for Voice Stream Communications for a year, and beginning in August, she's going to be in the PhD sociology program at Tulane.
And getting back to your discharge from the military and your integration back into life in America, let me ask you a little bit about your political character or your philosophical views after Vietnam. You described your affinity for democratic politics, most of which had been nurtured by your father, and your bonding with President Kennedy. Had your views or inclinations been altered at all by your military experience?
I think the Vietnam experience caused some reexamination of government and whether government was always right and whether it did the right things. I think that began more political involvement by me, or at least beginning to think about politics. Whereas before, other than being excited John F. Kennedy was president, didn't really matter much to me. I mean, and quite frankly, when I got back to the United States, I found out about the riots at the Democratic Convention in 1968, found out the tremendous upheaval that the country had gone through. And so I think that caused me to begin to think about whether the institutions of government were right and whether that was something that we needed to think about.
Did it cause you to get involved with any particular political party or movement?
No.
Many of which were going on in the late 60s and early 70s?
You know, there again, out of the Marine Corps, first thing I got is a job that I got to get a handle on, got married. Those were the things that were important to me back in those days.
How was Judge Carroll the business executive at Alderman Studio? What did you do for them?
Business executive is a little bit higher title than I had. I used to leave Greensboro, North Carolina on Monday mornings and travel to Chicago. I had a series of accounts that I called on, that I worked, and obviously in the sales, it was a sales job. You know, the secret was to get more business.
Did you?
I did, and actually was pretty successful at it. And I will tell everybody and tell you that being a salesman is the best training for anything in life. I mean, it really is. It's just, you know, the notion you got to ask for money if you want it, getting rejected, figuring out what works, what doesn't work. So it was great training.
How was that decision to enter law school finally made?
Starting in January of 71, I started thinking about doing something other than being a salesman. And I realized then that in order to, at least I thought that the best thing to do was get some sort of professional degree. And I thought about going into an MBA program, and I thought about law school. And it's probably, there's probably some osmosis going on that this is when I began to think that there was something that you could do to impact the country, that there were some things you could do to make social change. I don't remember when I finally had that conscious decision, but that's really, I think, the decision that drove me to law school. And I really do have some flashback, which is in my role as a salesman, riding with a client in Chicago along the expressway, looking at the projects in Chicago and the poverty and that sort of thing, and saying to myself, you know, maybe there's a better thing to do with your life than what you're doing. And that's when I started moving towards law school. And really, when all is said and done, I think the motivation to go to law school was that there is a notion that as a lawyer, as opposed to somebody with an MBA, you could have some sort of an impact on the country and life. And that really, that was the only profession that offered that opportunity.
Were there any persons who were role models or mentors for you at that point?
Nope.
Then how did you choose Cumberland Law School in Birmingham?
As I mentioned to you, I majored in, my minor in college was partying. So I took the LSATs. Got a good score on the LSATs, but I had awful undergraduate grades. And so when I started casting about for law schools, not everybody was just excited as they could be to enter, let me enter their doors. So my law school choices were limited. I just decided Birmingham as opposed to Macon or San Antonio. I wish there was some grander scheme, but that's just it.
Was it your first experience living in the Deep South, apart from, of course, the military communities you
visited? It was. And I'll always remember Susan and I came to Birmingham to get an apartment a couple of months before we actually moved to Birmingham, because we were going to visit some friends that were here at Maxwell Air Force Base, sort of southern swing. And that was my first, other than being in North Carolina in the military, that was my first trip ever to the South, and absolutely my first trip ever to Alabama.
Was it a rude awakening?
Not at that point. I mean, Birmingham was a fairly nice-looking city and, you know, didn't really have, we weren't there long enough to get any feel one way or the other.
How did you make the adjustment to law school from the military life?
As I tell everybody, it was so much better than getting shot at that, but seriously, by the time I got to law school, lots of things had happened in my life. I'd matured, I'd gotten self-discipline. So law school was not bad for me. I mean, I was ready for the challenge of law school, ready to buckle down, ready to commit myself to that, and I did.
And how soon after getting to Cumberland did you say to yourself, this is my calling, this is what I've been aiming to do?
I think as soon as I got there. I mean, I had some really interesting experiences. ran into some people at the law school that were sort of kindred spirits right away. And I remember the first thing we did, we hadn't been at the law school. First thing happened was the Attica riot. And I remember that generating a huge amount of discussion. And then there was a trial in Birmingham involving the Alabama Black Liberation Front. And we went down and watched that. And a bunch of us started volunteering at a place called Freedom House in Birmingham, which was for homeless and street people at the time. So one thing I was able to do at Cumberland was to connect with some sort of kindred spirits. And at that time, there were lots of folks that were in law school for the same reason, that there were social problems, that social problems needed to change at that point.
You then were rather active outside your law school classes. What type of law school student were you?
Well, I was a good student. I mean, finally having settled down, I ended up second in my class or third in my class. And so second semester freshman year, I got a straight A's. So I turned out to be a pretty good law student once I settled down.
How do you assess the value of your experience at Cumberland on your career as a lawyer and as a judge and even as a professor?
I think it was a great experience. I mean, the people I met, the contacts I made. I mean, I was able to go to the Southern Poverty Law Center because I went to Cumberland, because my senior year I was president of the student body. And Morris Dees came up to speak to the student body. And he and I got to chatting about, you know, what I was going to do next. And he said, why don't you send us an application? I did, and that's how I ended up at the Southern Poverty Law Center. Had I not gone to Cumberland, met Morris Dees, I would never have ended up there. So, you know, it's one of those, as I tell my daughter, things just kind of work out. You know, this kind of worked out. Maybe traditionally going to Harvard Law School would have been better, but in my life, the way things worked out, the fact that I ended up at Cumberland, best thing that ever happened to me.
Did you have any summer law clerkship experiences before you graduated Cumberland?
I worked full-time when I was in law school. After the end of my freshman year, I worked a full-time clerkship with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, and then worked with them all through my sophomore year while I was going to school, and then the summer of the sophomore year. So the only clerkship I had was with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
Now, you told us that you met Morris Dees, and that was your connection to your ultimate work with the Southern Poverty Law Center. Describe for us what the center was like. First, while you were in law school, what did you know about the Southern Poverty Law Center, and particularly what had influenced you to get Morris Dees to come to the campus?
Southern Poverty Law Center was in its relative infancy back in those days, but had already garnered a lot of publicity by the work it was doing in the civil rights area. And by then, I had decided that's something I really wanted to do. That was what I wanted to do, get into civil rights or some kind of indigent criminal defense.
Now, before you actually did that, I believe that you left Cumberland and went on to Harvard Law School?
Right, got a master's degree from Harvard.
And it was Professor Gamble who had that influence,
right,
to direct you there?
Yep.
What was Harvard like in 74, 75?
Harvard was really interesting. It was and obviously some radicals, some liberals, some conservatives, but just the educational experience of being there and being back in Boston was just tremendous. And the opportunity to study under the Harvard professors.
Are there any in particular who stand out?
Paul Freund, who was a constitutional law expert. I took a seminar in constitutional litigation from him, where he talked about his experience as Solicitor General. I mean, you know, those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. John Hart Ely, who later became Dean of Stanford, who taught federal practice and procedure. Great course that they made you take that I just said, this is the worst course I'll ever have. American legal history from like 1632 to 1695 or something like that, which was a spectacular course by a legal historian named Morton Horowitz. So, but I mean, the whole experience up there was just great.
Before you went to Harvard, had you already isolated a practice area of particular interest to you?
Well, I had already gotten the job with Morris before I went, so.
So it was during your time at Cumberland then that you acquired, would you say, a passionate interest in public interest law?
Yes.
What do you think sparked that?
it's just really hard to tell. Just a sort of a processing of all these experiences that that I had had. It just, they all sort of coalesced in this. There was no epiphany. There was no falling off the horse. It was just sort of a gradual coalescence of all my experiences led me in that direction.
So you left Harvard, came back to Alabama. Did you take the bar exam then, or did you take it?
I took it before I went back.
You began your career at the Southern Poverty Law Center in 75.
Right.
And spent almost 10 years there,
almost
didn't you?
Years.
You began as an attorney. You became legal director. Would you describe the center you came to in 75? Tell us a little bit about the work that you did, and if your work changed during that 9 or 10 year period. Comment on that for me, please.
The center was an incredible place to work back in those days. From looks, it was your sort of stereotypical street law place. I mean, we were over on South Hull Street in what would be described as a 50s bungalow. You know, we wore jeans to work, that sort of thing. But there was this real creative energy at the place at that time. When I got there, Morris and Joe Levin were there, Pam Horowitz was there, and then I was the fourth lawyer. And it was just a marvelous time. I mean, the legal issues were great, the people were great, the freedom was great. I mean, the first case I worked on, for example, was first case I landed in Montgomery in July 1975. Morris says, you got to come to North Carolina. He was in the middle of the Joanne Little case at the time. And that was my first experience with Morris, this major nationwide case with publicity all over the place, with people accusing Morris of being unethical right and left, and the other lawyers on the defense side. So that was a great experience.
Because this interview is being preserved for posterity, remind us about the Joan Little case and its place in the legal annals.
Joanne Little was an African-American woman who killed a jailer and escaped from a jail in rural North Carolina. And it presented huge amounts of social issues because race was involved, gender was involved, there were serious allegations that this jailer had tried to assault Joanne Little, and that's why she killed him. That was certainly her defense. The jury ultimately believed that defense and acquitted her. But being in rural North Carolina as part of Joanne Little's defense team was really, really interesting. And I also got to see firsthand, watch Morris work and watch people of his skill work, which was invaluable training. I mean, they took a case that for all intents and purposes was a dead loser and were successful with it because of the way they worked it.
You were fortunate then to leave law school and jump right into an activist practice.
Absolutely.
When you agreed to work with the Southern Poverty Law Center, did you know that you would be involved with death penalty litigation?
You know, I'm not sure. I just don't remember.
How long after working there did you have your first exposure to death penalty litigation?
I came back from the Joanne Little case. I was back in Montgomery maybe 3 days. Mara said, we've taken a case in South Georgia. You're an ex-Marine. This involves a Marine. You got to come work the case with me. What the person we were representing was a individual named Roy Patterson. He was a Marine sergeant stationed at the Marine base at Albany, Georgia. He and his brother were driving back from Albany to the interstate at Cordele, Georgia. Roy Patterson, his family, and his brother's family in one car when they were stopped by a state trooper for a taillight violation. Trooper, we believe, and I think the evidence established that he was abusive, that Roy spoke back to him, that the trooper then arrested Roy's brother for the taillight violation, took him to the police station in Cordele, Georgia. In the police station in Cordele, Georgia, a struggle ensued, and our client ended up killing the state trooper and a police officer. So we ended up in Cordele, Georgia in July of 1975, defending Roy Patterson.
Within months after graduating Harvard Law School in 75, you find yourself embroiled in a controversial death penalty case. What was your role, and what memories do you have of that first death penalty case?
Because it was my first, and because there was a fellow Marine involved, it really, I think, the memories are very fresh in my mind. The role that we had decided is Morris would really take the lead in the guilt phase of the case, that I'd assist him, you know, do some of the work involving the legal issues, but in terms of presentation of the testimony and that sort of thing, that would be pretty much his role. And then that if it went to a penalty phase, that is, if there was a conviction for murder, that I would take, along with the local lawyer who was C.B. King, would take the penalty phase. And that's the way it worked out.
What was the outcome of that Roy Patterson case?
The jury concluded that he was guilty of murder. And so that left the penalty phase to decide whether he'd live or die. Morris, as I said, had decided at that point to get out of the case. I mean, not actually, but that he thought the jury, having rejected the guilt phase, that it would probably be, from a credibility standpoint, better if I were there rather than he. And I think that's a technique that we later used and passed along to other lawyers. I think it's true. At any rate, you know, the closing argument to the jury, quite frankly, C.B. King, there were African-Americans on the jury, really talked to the African-Americans about issues involving traditional treatment of African-Americans by the police. I really was talking to the white jurors about Roy Patterson's role in the military, his role in the Marine Corps, his honorable service. The jury began deliberating the penalty phase and deliberated for an extremely long period of time, over a weekend, could not reach a verdict. And under Georgia law, if the jury could not reach a verdict, a life sentence had to be imposed. So I went home to Montgomery, got my wife to go back with me that Monday. Said, you know, it's interesting, come on back. So we arrived in the courthouse in Cordele on that Monday early in the morning. Jury still could not reach a verdict, deliberated all day. Late in the evening, we're in the courthouse in Cordele, and it's one of those, it's almost like a scene from a movie. All the African-Americans are on one side of the courtroom, and Susan and I and C.B. King are over on that side. All the family members of the victims, a lot of the white people in the Cordele community are on the right side of the courtroom. The back door's open, and you're looking at the judge, and there are two doors on either side of him. Those doors open, and armed law enforcement officers then ring the courtroom from beside the judge all the way in the back. I mean, it was obvious to all of us that they were about to bring in the jury, that this was a final and last attempt to intimidate the jury into returning a unanimous verdict of death. Of course, I jumped to my feet, told the judge they couldn't do this, told the bailiffs not to bring that jury anywhere near this place. We argued for a while. Judge was obviously realized that we had made a sufficient record, that if he continued to allow that, that we'd have a serious problem on appeal. So he rescinded. Law enforcement officers left the courtroom. My poor wife, Susan, who I had dragged over there, said she was convinced we were going to get shot at that point, but I was not so convinced. But late that evening, the judge finally declared that the jury could not reach a verdict, and so he imposed a life sentence. We're driving back to the motel and got run off the road by some irate Cordelians, whereupon Susan and I decided we're heading home. So we drove back to Montgomery that night. The Roy Patterson story has a sort of happy ending, in the sense that we fought his case through the Georgia Court of Appeals, we fought his case through the federal system, and finally, 10 years after the conviction, the 11th Circuit reversed his conviction. There's a real issue about whether or not we should try the case again. After long discussions with the client, he decided that at that point he would simply plead to time served and was released. So that was my first experience.
A rare happy ending.
A rare happy ending, although it did involve 10 years of prison for Roy. But he was a remarkable human being, and I kept track of him all through prison, visited him frequently. He became a Muslim in prison, a very devout Muslim, and you know, so he was able to make a positive out of that negative.
I am amazed at your report of your role during that time, because it seems unheard of that one fresh from law school would have the experience necessary to go into a Southern courtroom in mid-1970s and defend someone charged with a capital offense under the circumstances of the legal system then. What prepared you?
Just life experiences. I mean, at that point in time, I am 32 years old, almost 32, had been in the Marine Corps, been a traveling salesman, learned lots about life, and quite frankly, those capital cases back in those days were your ability to relate to people. And, you know, I knew the basic legal issues from having studied them and gotten up to speed on those, but this was more a human dynamic. I mean, representing a fellow Marine and that sort of thing. So it was just, I was mature at the time. I was 32 and had lots of experiences that prepared me to do that. Plus, you know, the local lawyer, C.B. King, who was a very famous civil rights lawyer in Georgia, mm-hmm. was, you know, there with me and worked together. So, mm-hmm.
Did that first experience serve as a foundation for your voluntary entry into death penalty litigation, or did you simply accept those cases because that's what the center did?
It's a combination of both, I think. I mean, death penalty presented huge numbers of issues relating to poverty, regardless of how you felt about the goodness or badness of the death penalty. I mean, the notions of racial issues, the notions of poverty, I mean, those were issues that ran then and still do run through the death penalty. So even regardless of how you came on, which side you came down on the debate about whether we ought to have capital punishment or not, those issues were there, and those issues were the same kind of issues that we were interested in at the center.
There have been few issues so frequently and vigorously debated in our country's history as the death penalty. Probably abortion is a close second, or maybe a tied for first. And it's those who are involved as lawyers representing persons charged with the death penalty are frequently outcast, not only by the legal society, but by the overall community. When, in your experience as a death penalty lawyer, did you begin to experience the negatives of representing the outcast in cases that were so unique because they involve life and death situations?
I don't know that I really ever experienced any sort of severe negativity that I wouldn't really expect. I was trying a capital murder case in Birmingham in, I can't remember, the late 70s, when the family of the victim came up to me and told me that they wished I'd rot in hell for what I was doing. But for some reason, the approach that we took to cases, and a lot of this is because of Morris, I think we were sensitive enough to everything that was going around that people ended up, when they first, while they might first have thought they didn't like us, they ended up understanding what we were trying to do and respecting us for it. It was a very interesting phenomenon. I'll relate one story. Morris and I tried a capital murder case in Arkansas in late 70s, early 80s. Young African-American man charged with killing a jail guard who was trying during an escape, who was, you know, loved by everybody in the community. And it was a fascinating issue, fascinating watching that community transform from they'd just soon kill us when we walked in the front door to they understood who we were, what we were doing, and why we were doing it. In fact, the district attorney that tried that case against us ended up going into private practice later and representing defendants charged with capital crime. So, I mean, I think it was really the approach and the sensitivity. The real skill that Morris had and the skill that he imparted to me was Southerners are not bad, evil people. They just, you have to understand where they're coming from and work that. I mean, working with him was really, his ability to motivate and persuade was remarkable. And I think, so Montgomery was probably the place we got the most heat because nobody in Montgomery really liked Morris. And if you were associated with Morris, they really didn't like you much. But never anything, you know, other than getting run off the road in Cordele and the offices getting firebombed by the Klan. That was really the only manifestation. So,
how much of your time at the center was dedicated to death penalty work?
Probably about 50%. You know, we were at the same time doing class action litigations and employment, prison conditions, and mental health stuff at that point in time.
You actually became legal director for the center at what point?
You know, I think it was 1978, 77, 78. something like that.
Within 3 or 4 years after your arrival. Right. And when you arrived, Morris himself was litigating frequently. Joe Levin was on board. You referenced, I think, Pam Horowitz.
Right.
How did the center change in the number of lawyers or its focus on law, poverty law issues during the 9 years that you were there?
Joe left to go with the Carter administration. When Joe left, we hired, and I don't have the exact hiring sequence, Dennis Balski, Ira Burnham, and Steve Ellman. Dennis was an experienced trial lawyer from Ohio. Steve and Ira were both Harvard undergraduate and Harvard law graduates. So they all came about the time that Joe left. And so at that point, we were traditionally focusing on death penalty and civil rights issues. Towards the mid-80s, Morris got involved in a case involving the Ku Klux Klan in North Alabama. And the issue revolved around the treatment of an African-American retarded man and then a shooting at a Klan rally that was spawned by the debate over how this African-American was treated. Decatur was in sort of full-blown war. The Klan, African-Americans were at one another. There were daily marches and demonstrations. And during one of these demonstrations, a Ku Klux Klansman was shot. We represented the individual charged with shooting the Ku Klux Klansman. And that was beginning of the center's involvement in the hate group activity. And that was in 83.
Let me see if I can have you isolate for us some of the highlights of the time you were at the center by focusing first on the death penalty litigation. Roy Patterson's case clearly is memorable because it was your first and because of your bonding with him as a Marine Corps. Looking back on the other cases that you handled in the death penalty area, which are memorable and for what reasons?
There was Johnny Ross. He was a 15-year-old on death row in Louisiana at the time. We represented him. He was charged with rape. We ended up in the post-conviction process being able to uncover some evidence that should have been presented earlier but was not. And again, he pled to time served and was released. We did a lot of appellate work involving the death penalty, and I argued two cases in the United States Supreme Court involving death penalty issues.
What years were those?
You know, I'm just not good at them.
I'm interested in knowing the makeup of the court when you made that argument.
83 and 85, maybe. I lost both of them, by the way.
But who were they? What about the makeup of the court?
Berger was the Chief Justice.
Okay.
That was the beginning of, you know, that was post-Warren, so.
Every litigator's dream, of course, is to stand before the 9 members of that U.S. Supreme Court and make an argument. Share with us your memories of that first case before the U.S. Supreme Court.
I was actually at the Supreme Court 4 times at counsel table. The first time was with Pam Horowitz when she argued a case called Dothard versus Rawlinson. We had sued the Department of Public Safety because they had a height and weight requirement for state troopers. If you were under 5'2" or under 140 pounds, you could not be a state trooper. Well, fortunately, we were able to convince the court that there were people that met that height and weight requirement that could not run 10 feet and couldn't do any of the physical requirements of the job. And so the court struck down that as a gender issue. So I was there watching Pam argue. A case called Beck versus Alabama that I wrote a lot of the brief on, but was argued by lawyers from New York. I was there for that argument. So by the time I actually got to argue, it was my 3rd time. So by then, it certainly had gotten less intimidating. And by the 4th time, it was not intimidating at all, but always an incredible experience. I mean, just to be there in the courtroom, in that court, and be part of the process. Although I will tell you that my last oral argument, the Chief Justice fell asleep during it, but I don't take that as the caliber of the argument. He was just tired at the time.
I was about to ask which of the justices left you with favorable or negative impressions, but you partially answered that.
Well, you know, Justice Berger fell asleep during my second oral argument. Both oral arguments, Justice Marshall always played the devil's advocate. He was just very gruff and would always attack the petitioner's side, even though in a death penalty case he was going to rule for you. He was always interesting. And Rehnquist, I recall him asking me a couple of questions. Brennan was fairly quiet. But I remember Justice White being very, very talkative during the second oral argument. So,
Johnny Ross, the 15-year-old in Louisiana, that surely is someone you'll recall among your death penalty clients. Are there others for various reasons?
Well, John Evans and Wayne Ritter are the two clients that I remember. They were ultimately executed. They asked for the death penalty, and we fought long and hard battles for them. Inmate in Florida named Benny Demps that I represented for many years, and he was executed last year after 25 years in the legal process.
Did you ever actually witness an execution?
No, did not.
Were you ever asked by any of your clients to do so?
Mm-mm.
Is that something that you ever wanted to do?
You know, if a client asked me, I'd do it, I think, but I have no desire to do it.
When you went to the center, would it be fair to describe you as someone who was fiercely opposed to the death penalty?
You know, I'm not satisfied that I ever framed an opinion one way or the other. It was just that there were issues relating to the death penalty that were important, that there was injustices, I thought, arising out of the use of the death penalty. So, I mean, I think there's a good faith debate on both sides of the death penalty.
So even your representation of persons charged with the death penalty didn't necessarily move you to a point of view that cast you in the category of pro or anti?
I think, you know, while I was at the center, I think I was perceived as being anti-death penalty, and I think I probably was. I think, like, as you develop anything in life, as my hair has gotten grayer, so have all other issues. And I think, particularly in this job, I mean, when I swore the oath to uphold and defend the Constitution, I also, part of that oath was that if I had the opportunity to impose a death sentence or affirm a death sentence, that I would do that. And so I was able to resolve that. I could do either of those things. I mean, I could rule fairly and impartially on any death penalty case, and I think I have. But having said that, I'm not confident the death penalty is a really good idea for a variety of reasons.
The death penalty litigation provide you with any skills that you found unique later on in your law practice or even as a judge?
There's really a two-part answer to that. Certainly the legal issues around the death penalty were incredibly challenging and I think gave me the opportunity to really think and work on very, very important constitutional issues. I think more importantly, though, on the trial side, the way that death penalty cases ended up being tried, the skills that were important are skills that you transferred over into the regular civil or criminal practice very easy. The notion of how important it was to relate and how important the emotional issues in a trial were, those sorts of things. So I think the death penalty litigation was a real benefit to me doing all other kinds of litigation.
And of course, the center was as active in civil rights litigation intended to benefit large numbers of classes. You've referenced some of them, in particular the ones involving the heightened weight requirements for state troopers. Were there other broad-based class action lawsuits during the time that you were at the center that you're particularly proud of?
Our work in the Alabama prison case, I mean, I think we, along with ACLU, and Ralph Knowles in particular, represented the inmates in the Alabama prison system conditions case for many, many years. And I think because of that litigation, conditions in the system were finally brought to a humane level. Same is true of the Alabama mental health system. We represented the persons committed to the Alabama Department of Mental Health for many years. And I think, again, because of that involvement, the level of treatment afforded those people was significantly increased.
On the prison case, you're referring to the Newman
lawsuits. Newman v. Alabama.
And
Wyatt v. Sawyer.
Mental health.
Actually, one of the small case that I'll always remember, first case I ever filed as a civil case at the center, was on behalf of an African-American woman who was at John Patterson Technical School and Cosmetology School. And they would not let her work on the hair of Caucasians. Filed that lawsuit. Judge Johnson got the case, agreed with us.
Did you yourself participate in some of the Klan, anti-Klan, anti-hate group litigation that the center ventured into in the early 80s?
I represented the individual in Decatur charged with shooting the Klansman. Morris and I tried that case. That was right as I was getting ready to leave the center. And so I never really, after I left the center, I did some legal work, wrote some briefs, gave some advice to the center lawyers on a case they filed in Houston, Texas to get an injunction to keep the Klan from harassing Vietnamese fishermen. So I had some part in that case. And I also had some part in developing the legal theories that Morris ultimately ended up using in Mobile against the United Klans of America for hanging the young African-American person down there. Mm-hmm. So until I took this job, I really had sort of consistent contact with him over these issues, but did not represent the center or any of its clients after the Decatur incident.
Those familiar with the work of the center, particularly during the time that you were there, are also aware that Marstees and the lawyers who worked with him were constantly facing threats of personal injury or death. Did you yourself or your family experience any close calls during the time that you were with the center?
We got run off the road over there in Cordele, Georgia, and then the only other time was on my daughter's third birthday. Our offices got firebombed. I had just come back from Florida working on a death penalty case, got in late, 3 o'clock in the morning. I get a phone call from Morris saying our offices are burning. So I jump in the car, head down to the center, and sure enough, the offices were on fire. By then, the fire department was there and pretty much had it under control. And it was sort of surreal. I left that and at noon went to my daughter's birthday party at Chuck E. Cheese. So, other than that, I never got any death threats or anything like that.
So overall, how would you describe your 9 or 10 years at the center?
An incredible experience, one that I always treasure and one that's been beneficial to me whatever I've done since then.
Why did you leave?
Time for some new challenges.
What challenges did you find?
Went to full-time law teaching after a brief period of time in private practice.
What attracted you to teaching?
The ability to study the law, the ability to discuss the law, the ability to interact with bright people about the law, and the ability to perhaps make some contribution or influence some lawyers.
Had teaching been something that was in the back of your mind even when you were at Harvard or Cumberland?
I think I began thinking about law teaching because the LLM at Harvard was really designed for that approach, that if you took an LLM from Harvard, eventually you'd go into teaching. I guess I got into it because as we started doing death penalty cases, people then began asking us to speak about our experiences and lessons learned and that kind of stuff. And I actually had done some instruction when I was in the Marine Corps. And I think just that kind of all came together. And when the opportunity to return to go to law teaching arose, I took it.
What was your first opportunity in law teaching?
I was a professor at Mercer University in Macon, Georgia at their law school in 1985 and 86.
And what did you teach there?
Constitutional law, criminal procedure, and evidence.
How would you describe that experience?
Again, another incredibly good experience. The colleagues at Mercer were great people. The courses I had to teach were incredibly interesting. And the interaction with the students was great.
During that time, did you become more cemented in your aspiration to be a law professor, or did you find yourself in search of even other challenges within your career?
I really liked law teaching. At that point, I had really begun to think about whether I wanted to begin practicing a little bit on the side or do some consulting work just for more challenges.
Now, you became a federal magistrate judge in 1986.
Right.
Here in the Middle District of Alabama.
Right.
What month was that?
November.
All right. Why did you apply for that position?
You know, I think the aspiration of all of us who practiced in federal court was to someday be a federal judge, to be on the other side of that bar and that bench. And I think that's what motivated me. When the opportunity to come back to this district, and I really do say this district, I don't believe that I would have applied anywhere else in the country.
Is that because most of your practice while at the center was focused right here in the federal
right.
court?
And I had a real love for this district. I mean, I practiced in front of Judge Johnson, and I practiced in front of Judge Varner, and I, you know, had great experiences here. And there's just something special about the judiciary in this district. There certainly was to me then, and there certainly is to me now.
The opportunity arose then for you to come back to federal court here, and you assumed that in 1986, and you have been a magistrate judge continuously for over 14 years now.
Right.
Is that correct? The magistrate judge bench here in the Middle District has certainly evolved during that time. Would you agree, Judge Carroll?
Absolutely.
Give us some perspective on that evolution. And if you would, start with your predecessors and bring us up to when you assumed the role.
The modus operandi of the magistrate judges when I got here, and when I got here, Judge Gwaltney was a magistrate judge. Judge Dabena had been one, but had then been elevated to the district court bench. So I took Judge Dabena's slot. So really the modern era with magistrate judges began with Judge Gwaltney and Judge Dabena. Judge Gwaltney was utilized mainly to do preliminary work in criminal cases and preliminary work in prisoner cases. And that was the role that the district court assigned to him. And the interesting thing about the magistrate judge position is that it is flexible and is designed to be of assistance to the district court. So depending where you are in the United States, magistrate judges are utilized in different ways. And so when I got here, the traditional utilization of magistrate judges had been preliminary criminal proceedings, prisoner cases. And a Judge Dabena really began what I will call the transition, which is he was very well qualified, former clerk to Judge Varner, well-respected practitioner. So when he took the magistrate judge position, I think it elevated it in the eyes of the bar and of the judges of the district court. So he began the move for more responsibility to the magistrate judges. I took his place. Then in May of 1987, Judge Coody came on board to replace Judge Gwaltney, who had retired. And we both then began to seek more responsibility in the position.
During the period between 1986 and 92, before Judge McPherson came on board, describe for us, if you will, how you and Judge Coody transformed the post of magistrate judge for the Middle District.
I think the real key was when Judge Thompson became chief judge, he was receptive to new ideas about how the caseload of the court could be managed more efficiently. And so we at that point suggested that we be given expanded duties, particularly in the civil area, that we begin handling civil discovery, we be given expanded duties in the criminal area, that we start handling arraignments and have perform more pretrial functions, and he was very receptive to that.
So much so that presently the magistrate judge position here in the Middle District is how comprehensive?
It is as comprehensive. We do everything that the statute authorizes us to do. And quite frankly, in circles throughout the country in the federal judiciary, we are looked upon as a model for the use of magistrate judges, both by the way we're utilized, the relationships we have with the district judges, and that sort of thing. So,
specifically with reference to criminal litigation, what is the role of the magistrate judge here in the Middle District 2001?
The magistrate judges handle all the preliminary proceedings in criminal cases, and they manage the criminal cases. That is, they set schedules, take guilty pleas, set trial dates, and in addition, they handle all of the dispositive criminal motion and non-dispositive criminal motion practice. So a district judge does not see a case until it is either ready, until it's tried or sentencing. So we would handle everything up to that.
Similarly, how has the civil caseload evolved for the magistrate judges here in the Middle District?
We handle all of the discovery in civil cases and then have a substantial consent caseload. The consent caseload affects 28 United States Code Section 636C, which says that the parties in a civil case can agree to have a magistrate judge exercise case dispositive jurisdiction. We're on, to use a technical term, on the wheel. That is, 40% of all civil cases are randomly assigned to the magistrate judges, and the parties are given the opportunity to consent, which means that in those cases they act like a district judge, that they exercise all the powers and authority that a district judge has. And that's been a very successful program. The bar has accepted all of the magistrate judges as competent trial judges and routinely consent to have us dispose of their cases.
It sounds like middle district magistrate judges have very little time to do anything more than manage their caseloads.
Well, we're busy. But it's a busyness that's productive and rewarding.
Over the 14 years plus that you have served, what have been your greatest challenges as a judge managing your caseload?
Simply keeping up with the everyday flow of paperwork and managing the cases to make sure that no cases languish, to make sure that everybody gets a fair hearing within a reasonable period of time. Those are the real challenges.
Now, you have been and are now Chief Magistrate Judge.
Right.
Is that correct? For how long have you had that?
Since 1995.
What additional responsibilities have you had as Chief Magistrate Judge?
The Chief Magistrate Judge really acts as the liaison between the court, the district judges, and the magistrate judges on policy issues. He develops, or she would develop, policy for a variety of issues and just generally works procedural matters among the magistrate judges.
How easy was it for you to make the transition from almost a decade as a prime litigator, controversial cases, to teaching and then to being a judge?
I think the transition I had was the transition that everybody goes through, which is the transition from advocate to neutral decider is not easy for anybody. The understanding that you did not have a side, that you had to rule fairly and impartially on whatever you had in front of you, it takes a while. I don't know that it was difficult, but it certainly isn't something that immediately happens. I mean, you have to constantly work at, I am a judge, I am not on one side or the other of this, I've got to call it straight down the middle.
For you, was that particularly challenging since you had been an advocate for most of your
practice? It's interesting. I came into this position with all sorts of stereotypes. I'd represented the Alabama prisoners. I'd done death penalty litigation. I'd always been a criminal defense lawyer. And I think everybody thought I was going to bend over backwards to help prisoners and defense litigants. Well, I think I am now viewed as exactly the opposite, that I'm probably tougher on those people than my colleagues are. And I don't think it was any more difficult for me than it would be for somebody who'd come from the other side. I think it's difficult for everybody. But, I mean, I think I can say without fear of contradiction that the judges of this court who have come from incredibly varied practice backgrounds are perceived by the lawyers as being all down the middle and fair.
What are some of the changes you have seen in the lawyers who practiced before you? And I'm referencing in particular the fact that you were part of the Montgomery legal community for a number of years with an active practice here in the federal court. Tell us about your observations of the lawyers who've appeared before you and what concerns you've had about that.
One major change is there really is not much of a Montgomery federal court bar anymore. Mm-hmm. When I was here in the 70s, there was a close-knit group of federal lawyers mm-hmm. that were in federal court all the time. That's not really true anymore. We see lots of lawyers from Atlanta, lots of lawyers from Birmingham, lots of lawyers from Mobile, but not so many, particularly on the plaintiff's side, lawyers from Montgomery. Back in the old days, remember, there's a huge Montgomery Civil Rights Plaintiffs Bar. Not huge, but fairly distinguished, and that's kind of gone. There aren't a lot of lawyers in Montgomery on the plaintiff's civil side. The other thing is just the difference in the law practice in general. Incredibly more expensive, incredibly more antagonistic, in much more conflicted than even 10 years ago. Lawyers don't seem to get along as well as they used to. Lawyers don't seem to be as prepared as they used to. And I see it most in the young lawyers that I don't think, I don't know how you and I got trained, but somehow we did. And I think I know how you and I got trained, which is we had people with us that sort of mentored us mm-hmm. and talked with us and helped us. Plus, we were absorbing all during that period of time. And the young lawyers don't seem to be doing that. There's also another phenomenon at operation, and that is in the legal culture of the new millennia, whether it's in state or federal court, almost nothing ever goes to trial. So lawyers don't get trial skills. I mean, you and I, when we were younger, tried lots of cases. Mm-hmm. Lawyers don't try cases anymore. So there is a real dearth of really good trial skills. I mean, there's statistics floating around 2% of the cases in federal court and about 1.5% of the cases in state court ever get to trial.
Why are there so few cases tried these days in federal court?
It's interesting. Judge Albritton is on a subcommittee that is studying that issue, but I think the answer is twofold. Number one is that summary judgment after the so-called trilogy of the late 80s is now a very potent weapon in the hands of the defendants, that summary judgment is granted far more frequently than it was before the trilogy. I mean, again, when you and I were litigating, the case law of the 5th and 11th Circuit was rife with summary judgment is rare, you know, particularly in cases involving intent or state of mind or civil rights mm-hmm. cases, sure. And that day is over. The day is now you've got to present evidence on the essential elements of your claim. And if you fail to do that, you're out of court. And I think that's what, so the development of the summary judgment motion, I think, is a major factor. And the other is, I think, lawyers don't try cases anymore. And so they're scared to try cases. And so they'll settle. And I think there's also another problem, and that is businesses don't want to try cases. They're concerned about big verdicts. And there's just a real culture against trial.
Now, magistrate judges, particularly in this district, have a specific role to play to facilitate settlement,
right,
and that's called mediation. Mediation is something that did not exist, or did it, when you became a federal magistrate judge?
It did not exist.
Tell us how that evolved and
really
what your role has been.
It was an outgrowth of the self-study that federal courts did because of the passage of the Civil Justice Reform Act. Congress decided, and I don't have the exact date, probably close to 10 years ago, that federal courts ought to look at ways of reducing the cost of litigation and the delay in litigation. And so as a result, many, many courts began looking at mediation and arbitration, and now there's a more formal act that's come out that sort of requires all that. So that is a major now part of federal litigation that and also in state court. Mediation, arbitration, these alternative dispute resolution mechanisms have been overlaid on the trial process. Now, this district still has, the program's totally voluntary. I mean, if the lawyers don't want to get into it, they don't. Other districts, it's mandatory, although we've heard some lawyers complain that perhaps it's more mandatory in this district than it's supposed to be.
In this district, what is the magistrate judge's role in mediation?
We actually conduct the mediations. We're referred the case for mediation by either one of the district judges or one of our own colleagues.
Has that experience proved to be helpful in managing the cases here in the Middle District?
Mediation? It has. I think mediation is generally considered to be a very successful program here. And the advantage, of course, here is that there's no cost to the litigants. We're free.
What other significant changes have you witnessed during your tenure as a magistrate judge? And I'm speaking in particular about either the category of cases being litigated, changes in rules, for example, discovery rules, any that you feel good having been a part of, or you will look back on and say the practice of law, particularly in federal court, changed for the better or for the worse because of this occurrence?
Start out with the case mix. I think the case mix in federal court is much changed. The days of the major and far-reaching civil rights actions, I think, are gone forever. Whether or not they're any of those kind of issues around, or the court's just not receptive to them, is hard to tell. But the major issues of race and gender have really been decided. Probably the most significant thing that happened is the Civil Rights Act of 1991, which put juries and punitive and compensatory damages in employment cases. Prior to that, it was a judge-only case, and equitable relief was all that was available. What that has caused is a incredible increase in the number of employment cases filed in this district. And so this is a district where the employment caseload is very, very heavy.
Give us an idea.
You know, I think it's probably 50% of all the civil cases that are filed.
And this middle district handles approximately how many civil
About
cases annually?
1,800. Right. So I think that's one thing. And I think, in all candor, that what we see are lots of marginal cases, cases that would not have been brought by the lawyers with only a judge involved, which has a dual effect. I think it has caused a tightening down in the appellate courts of the law involving these cases, because weak cases percolate to the courts of appeals, forces them to tighten down the legal requirements, and I think as a result, civil rights plaintiffs in employment cases are worse off than they were before the Civil Rights Act of 1991. So that's one major change. The other is some major changes in the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. I've been a member of the Advisory Committee on the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure for 6 years, and we have constantly tinkered with the discovery process mainly, and I think we're finished with that, but there have been some major changes. The advent of mandatory disclosure, that is, where lawyers are required to exchange information without any sort of discovery request, is a major change. Limits on depositions, changes in the standard of relevance. So those have been major changes, although I'm not satisfied those changes have had a major impact. But I think the most significant factor is the change in the way the role of a federal judge is viewed and the skills that a federal judge possesses that are now praised. And that is that we have now become managerial judges. That is, we are really case managers rather than, I think, deciders. That came about, I think, again, as a process of evolution, that we're not rated on how we decide cases, quite frankly. We are rated on whether we got any motions pending for more than 6 months, whether we got any cases pending for more than 3 years. The message of all that is, do something with the cases. Get them off your CJRA report. Get them moving. Get them decided. We're case managers. Now, I think there's a great philosophical debate about whether that's a good or bad idea, given the present case mix in federal court, and I think those are issues to be decided by a much more lengthy debate later. But clearly now, the skills I think that are praised are, how well are you managing your caseload? How well are you clearing your docket? That kind of thing.
During the time that you found yourself as a magistrate judge being more of a decider rather than a case manager, can you share with us any of the opinions that you are proud to include as part of your legacy?
I really can't. I mean, I think I've written lots of interesting stuff, and particularly in areas that had nothing to do with my previous life. I mean, I've written some ERISA opinions, for example, that are getting cited, and I've written some discovery opinions that are getting cited, but there's nothing really that stands out. I mean, you know, I've tried to do as good a job as I can with everything I've gotten, but there's not anything really that jumps out at me.
What have you enjoyed most about this 14-year period being a federal magistrate judge?
The relationships with the other judges and the relationships with lawyers. I mean, I have had the opportunity to travel all over the country, and there really is not a more collegial district in the United States than this one. I mean, we're very different people, all of us, but we really do get along, and really do get along and respect others as judges. many districts, there's a real hierarchy between the magistrate judges and the district judges. And I can list lots of horror stories for you, but in this district, there has never been that hierarchy. I mean, we are treated as equals, and we all get along. I mean, we have our disagreements, we have our differences, but by and large, it's a joy to come to work every day because of the people you're associating with.
You alluded to this earlier, that is the difference in how magistrate judges work and are perceived and are used in the Middle District in contrast to their perception and use in other districts. Even within the state of Alabama, is it a fact that magistrate judges in the Middle District possess more opportunities or have more opportunities to actually do more work?
Birmingham and Mobile are similarly structured, but in this district, the lawyers give us that opportunity. I mean, the lawyers are far more receptive to us handling case dispositive matters than they are in the other two districts. So I think the experience here as a magistrate judge is better than it would be anywhere else in the country. But I also have to praise our district judges. They have been willing to pick, and this will sound like blowing my own horn, but I apologize. I think they've been willing to pick the most qualified candidate for the job, regardless of that candidate's background and regardless of that candidate's political views. And I think that's made this district a success, that they've gone out and got the best person for the job and not cared what the sort of fallout from that decision might be.
Has being a judge changed John Carroll's basic persona?
I would hope not, and I don't think it has.
Your political philosophies, inclinations?
Probably made me a little more conservative. As I mentioned earlier, things are just not as black and white as they used to be. I think things are a lot grayer. So I think I am probably more conservative than I was 15 years ago.
Well, you certainly were a different person after leaving the Marine Corps, and you've shared with us those perspectives. Do you think the difference on record when you, Captain Carroll, emerged from the Marine Corps are substantially different than those now as Judge Carroll following a 14-year stint on the federal magistrate bench?
I don't think so. I mean, I really do hope and think I am the same person I was back then. I just have lots more experience and lots of different things.
Now, you've been fortunate as a judge to still have the opportunity to experience your love of teaching law. Is that right? Tell us a little bit about that.
Since I've been a judge, I've been on the adjunct faculty at the University of Alabama and have taught criminal procedure down there, as well as most recently a course in complex litigation. That's been great because it's forced me to keep up in those areas of the law and also continued my interaction with faculty and students.
When did you start your association with the university's law school?
About 10 years ago.
We will note that you have just been appointed the new dean at your alma mater, the Cumberland Law School. And you're about to begin that position when?
In 2 weeks from today.
What attracted you to that post?
The fact that it was my alma mater and the opportunity that rarely is afforded to lead your law school, to make a change in that law school, to make a change in the students that come through that law school. It's just not an opportunity that presents itself every day.
You're looking forward to that challenge.
I am. I mean, I'm excited about it at the same time, obviously apprehensive about going into an entirely new field, but I mean, as you can kind of tell from my life, I have consistently sought challenge, and this is another one.
What do you expect to find there different about the law school, the student body, the faculty?
Well, I mean, I've already discovered it in the sort of process that mm-hmm. led to my appointment. The faculty is significantly better. The approach to the law is much different because the skills that you and I were taught in law school are no longer the skills that are necessarily important. I mean, now we have negotiation and mediation.
you as you look back on your time thus far as a lawyer, a teacher, a judge? Are there any regrets?
I really don't have any. I have been just incredibly blessed with phenomenal career opportunities and working with great people.
And I want to thank you for allowing me to let others have a little peek at the life of Judge John Carroll. Thank you very much.
And thank you.